ring the bell.
Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to another lecture sponsored by the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational scientific and research organization dedicated to showing proof in existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operations of eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was founded as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifton Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. The school was incorporated in the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now in this school, we teach by the true and original names and titles that are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The true name of the Holy Spirit manifest in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles. They are not names. As the Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5, there's Lord's many and there's God's many. But we now know that every Lord must have a name and every God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that the Creator has chose this title for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove to you that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, or the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was a letter J in any other language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and correct name of the Father and the Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, the substance, the limits, and the bounds of everything. We have Yahweh drawn. Yahweh chose to symbolize himself as a cloud. We have this cloud drawn around the edge of this chart to show you how that everything on this chart abides within the cloud.
Yahweh is not a cloud.
Yahweh is not a cloud. He chose to symbolize himself as a cloud because the cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of the chart to show you how that everything on the chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything within the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not receive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This spirit form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. This self-same spirit later manifested in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua Messiah, in whom the world calls Jesus Christ. That there's only one name unto salvation, and we should all know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. We call it divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him this tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed him to build one in the wilderness exactly like the one that he saw in the mount. Now the tabernacle consists of the most holy place, a holy place, and a court around about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth to show proof in this school how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and the function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the school are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as He really is and as He actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, the so-called laws of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult sciences. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticisms, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seven, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan, his demons, operating the mischief of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eight is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in a new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is to speak the truth. We're going to start this evening class with a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. We're going to have a scripture lesson read by Dr. Bud Wunsch. And then following that, we'll have a song by Dr. Lisa Zizi.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's time of prayer. It's all about our heart and mind. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for allowing us to be here tonight. The only purpose to learn about you, all the creation you laid down for ourselves, to show you your power, your strength, all the principles, attributes you pour into mankind. Give us, as I say, knowledge, wisdom, understanding to know you more better. I say all those things in your only sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
I think he should use the headset.
I'm going to commandeer about 60 seconds here with hopes that those that hear these words will understand. Dr. Lisa, you're going to provide us with song. I had the pleasure of being the first MC at the 1975 convention in Washington, D.C. And the founder was sitting there, and when he saw on the program that we were not going to have a song, he goes, oh, no, we do not start a class without a song. And he called from the audience Dr. Pamela Snellbaker, who was the leader of the choir of the Pomona class. And we had that song. And throughout the rest of the convention, there was a song for every class. So you're doing a great job in providing a service that the founder thought was essential. And with that, I will be reading tonight to you the ninth chapter of Hebrews. I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible. This Bible was critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trena. He happened to be an Italian Jew, and he was with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. This particular Bible was reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Hebrews the ninth. Then verily, the first covenant had also orders of service and a worldly sanctuary. For in the first compartment of the tabernacle were the candlestick, the table, and the showbread, which is called the holy place. And beyond the veil, the second compartment of the tabernacle, which is called the Holy of Holies, which had the golden censer and the Ark of the Covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna, and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant. And over it, the cherubim of glory, shadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly. Now when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service. But unto the second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. The Holy Spirit signifying this, that the way into the Holy of Holies was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices, that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meal and drink offerings and various washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. But the Messiah, being a high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifieth for the purifying of the flesh. Did I skip one? No, I didn't. How much more so shall the blood of Yahshua, who the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to the Most High, purge your conscience from death-causing works to serve the living Elohim? And for this purpose, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death for the redemption of transgressions of the First Testament, those which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where a covenant is, there must of necessity be the death of that which ratifies. For a covenant is made firm over the death of the victim. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while that which ratifies is alive. Whereupon neither the first covenant was confirmed without blood. For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant which Yahweh hath enjoined unto you." Moreover, he sprinkled likewise with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. It is therefore necessary that the pattern of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For the Messiah is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of Yahweh for us. Nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entered into the holy place every year with other blood. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now, once in the end of the age, hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. So the Messiah was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin offering unto salvation. Hebrews the 9th.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Get them all mic'd up. Hello, Lisa Zizey again from the Tampa, Florida branch of the IDMR. I'm happy to be here. And I'm singing a song, another song by Judith Turner, who is the vice president of our class in Tampa. And she wrote and composed it, and it's called Do You Know?
Thank you. Hey, good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's good to be here. Good to see you all here. Man, I really appreciate the music. You know? Like Bud, I got a 75 convention story too, but that was the first time. I was a choir director, and I had started a choir in St. Louis, and that was our really big debut that year. And we only had three songs. We did two of them, and we had a third one just in case we needed it. You know? So, I agree about the song. There's something about songs. You know, you can even find it in the scriptures. You know, about songs. You know, uplifting, and you know, Joshua and his disciples, they sang songs. You know, David wrote songs, especially he was a musician himself, and he played particularly before he went out to battle. You know, he inspired. That's where a lot of times, you know, in the military, you've been in the military. You know, they train you to do song. You know, cadence, you be marching, this is a workshop, and in a workshop is really informal. Anybody, I'm more or less the conductor up here, if anything, and people can ask questions, you know, like her, because she always asks questions over there, you know, but, you know, you have to be careful there, because there's something wrong with this. This is up here.
Okay.
Yeah, hold on. You're gonna have to. Yeah.
I'll do less swinging over there.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So this should be fine at this moment. Maybe I may have to get another cord for that. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, madam. Go ahead and ask your question.
Well, you know, I was talking about how you read something over and over, and then all of a sudden, one word pops out at you. Well, this verse number 7, Hebrews 9:7, but into the second with the high priest alone once every year, not without blood. I never saw that blood before. I mean, I never noticed it. So did he go out and catch these sacrifices and bring it in and sacrifice them on the altar? I mean, where did the sacrifices come from?
Yeah, the sacrifices, okay.
Every year, not without blood.
This is talking about going into the most holy place on the Day of Atonement.
Okay.
See here. Here he is right here. Yeah, the Holies of Holies. That's the most holy place. The most holy place, or Holies of Holies. Here's the high priest up here. This is the Day of Atonement, and he has the censer in his hand, and he has the blood in his hand from down here, because there were three sacrifices. Now, let's try to understand where, you know, because I think your general question is, well, where did the Levites get all this stuff from?
Right.
Right.
I mean, where did the blood come from is the question.
No, the blood came from the animals that were sacrificed.
But who brought the animals for the sacrifice?
The sinners.
Let me put it like this. For that particular day, that was chosen out from the animals that they had, without spot or blemish, etc. Okay, because see, the Levites up here in Canaan's land had no inheritance.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the other tribes had to give a tithe or a tenth of what they had to contribute to the Levites. Right? The Levites had 48 cities up here. I can't even hear myself now. And they had 48 cities scattered throughout the 12 tribes, but they had no land themselves. But the other tribes contribute what they had, I mean, toward the Levites, and as well as the tabernacle and the temple. And that stood in goods like, sheep, goats, oxen, materials and stuff. It was the that's where the Christians get the tithing from, the tenth portion. You know, give a tithe of your salary or a tenth of your salary. So they get it from this,
mm-hmm.
Okay, from what the other tribes had to do for the Levites.
Diezmo. This is the way they call the Christians.
Was that called in Spanish?
Yeah.
I'll see if I can try to find that scripture where. where Yahweh stipulated that. Let me see.
About the tithing?
What now?
About the tithing?
Yeah, yeah. For the Levites, because they didn't, because, yeah, I know it, I think it's like in, it's either Numbers or Deuteronomy, one or the other. Okay. Well, it's concordance time. That's what that is. It's a school, and we do research, correct?
Mm-hmm. What's some of the words in the phrase?
Tithe. Tithe. I think that might be a central word. T-H-I.
T-I-T-H-E.
What? T-I-T-H-E. You said
T-H-I? T-I-T-H-E.
Okay, well, how come you haven't found it there?
Latin is decim. Decim means ten.
There's something in Leviticus that talks about one tenth.
Where is that at, man?
Well, it's Leviticus 27:32, and it says, all the tithe of herd or flock, everything which passes under the rod, the tenth one shall be holy to Yahweh.
Okay, the what scripture was that?
Leviticus 27:32.
27:32, okay. All tithes, lands, trees, okay.
There's also one in Numbers.
Okay, that's, see, I have a Schofield, so once you get one, you can get connected to the others. That's a good one. Why don't you read that, which the one she just quoted.
It starts before that, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, 30, start at 30.
There you go.
Leviticus 30?
Leviticus 27 and 30.
Oh, 27 and 30.
Yes.
Leviticus 27 and...
How come we can't hear you?
I don't know, this microphone, I'm talking right into it, because I don't swallow it.
Go ahead.
And all the tithe of the land, whether the seed of the land or the fruit of the tree, is Yahweh's. It is holy unto Yahweh. And if a man will at all redeem aught of his tithes, he shall add thereon the fifth part thereof. And concerning the tithe of the herd or of the flock, even of whatsoever passeth under the rod, the tenth shall be holy unto Yahweh.
Okay.
Shall not search whether it be good or bad, neither shall he change it. And if he change it at all, then both it and the change thereof shall be holy. It shall not be redeemed. These are the commandments which Yahweh commanded Moses for the children of Israel to Mount Sinai.
I think there's a better one in Numbers.
Yeah, I have that one because I got a Schofield. I have a Schofield in me there. I was just waiting.
Sure.
Yeah, read Numbers 18:21. This is the scripture I believe that. Start with 20. Start with 20. 18 and Numbers 18:20. Start there because that's the scripture I think I want.
And Yahweh spake unto Aaron,
uh-huh.
Thus shalt thou have no inheritance in their land.
Now see, he's telling Aaron. He's talking to Aaron. He's also talking to the Levites.
Mm-hmm.
See, he said, look, you shall have no inheritance in this land.
That's right.
Neither shalt thou have any part among them.
Uh-huh.
I am thy part and thine inheritance among the children of Israel.
Why? Because they had the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
That was in the midst of them. That was their ordained duty, so to speak. I'm talking about the Levites. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And behold, I have given the children of Levi all the tenth in Israel for an inheritance.
So now I've given Levi all the a tenth.
See, meaning that all the other tribes had to give a tenth part of what they had to the Levites because they had no land inheritance up here in Canaan. Go ahead.
For their service which they serve, even the service of the meeting tent of the congregation.
Mm-hmm.
Neither must the children of Israel henceforth come nigh the meeting tent of the congregation, lest they bear sin and die. But the Levites shall do the service of the meeting tent of the congregation, and they shall bear their iniquity. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations, that among the children of Israel they have no inheritance.
Read.
But the tithes of the children of Israel.
But the tithes, but the other tribes, 12 tribes, had to give, read.
Which they offer as an heave offering unto Yahweh, I have given to the Levites to inherit.
Given it to the Levites to inherit. Okay, read.
Therefore I have said unto them, among the children of Israel they shall have no inheritance.
Okay. So now that's how they got the lambs, the cows, the materials for the tabernacle, and so forth and so on. Right here. This is page 81 in the first volume of the textbook. All right. Okay. Which is the diagram of the camp of the Israelites. Mm-hmm. And see, okay, zoom in here a little closer. Come a little closer. And you can see on the bottom here, the tribes of, you can see Aaron and his two sons, Eleazar and Ithamar. Mm-hmm. And then you see over here, the other Levitical families of Kohath and his sons. And then Moses and his sons, Gershom and their sons. And they had the different Levitical families had different duties as concerning the tabernacle. Kohath and his family, they took care of the sanctuary vessels. Gershom and his family took care of the cords and the curtains. And Merari and his family took care of the boards, the bars, the pillars. That is to say this, when the cloud moved, because they followed the cloud out in the wilderness, mm-hmm. Okay? So when the cloud moved, let's look over, see if you can come over here.
Okay.
Just be careful.
Okay.
All right. Okay, zoom on in here. Yeah, see, here's the cloud
there
over the tabernacle. Yeah. See, and then you have encamped about. And the Levitical tribes were the inner tribes closest to the tabernacle. Yeah. So when the cloud moved, it was their duty to those Levitical tribes and those Levitical families to break down the tabernacle and carry these vessels following the cloud. And then when the cloud stopped, it was their duty to assemble the tabernacle so that the cloud would fill it and sit on the Ark of the Covenant. Mm-hmm. See, that was their duty, talking about the Levitical families.
Yeah.
Right? Their inheritance was the tabernacle, literally. And after the tabernacle was here on Mount Zion for 45 years, actually. Because see, when it was in Canaan's land, most of the time it was in Shiloh, and it didn't get to Jerusalem not until the reign of David. Jerusalem prior to David. Even Joshua, son of Nun, when he conquered Canaan's land, never conquered Jerusalem, which at the time was called Salem. Well, actually, at the time it was called Jebus.
Jebus.
It was called Jebus. It was the capital and the home of the Jebusites.
Yeah.
All right. And it wasn't until David conquered Jebus that he renamed it back to Jerusalem, and then he moved the tabernacle into the city and put it on Mount Zion, and there it stayed for 45 years until after the completion of the temple, and then the articles were moved from the tabernacle into the temple. This is after 45 years, okay? Mm-hmm. And then so that the temple was really an expanded version of the tabernacle. But the way the founder put it, when you understand the principle, the temple came first before the tabernacle. Or that was the tabernacle came out of the temple. And when he said that, what he's talking about is really up here. Because mm-hmm. the true temple is Elohim himself.
Right.
Out of which the tabernacle came forth, which was shown to Moses. And so, so the tabernacle in reality came out of the temple, and we're seeing here in type the temple, the tabernacle just going back
right
into the temple.
Very good. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I want the scripture where it talks about the cities, the Levitical cities, and that they were given. They were given 48 cities. I can find this city. There's a scripture on that. Well, you gotta jiggle it. Don't let it, you know, don't be scared of it. You're gonna, you know, we're gonna have to
move it.
No, just look. It has to be perpendicular. And it can't move. So we're gonna have to adjust this so that when you do that. And then, see.
Okay.
See, so that it doesn't give much leeway.
Okay.
Do you want the scripture or just the names of the cities?
I want the scripture. There you go.
Okay.
I want this.
Good up and down.
Yeah. All right. Maybe if you look up the word
Numbers
48.
Numbers 35, what? It says on
what, say what now?
Numbers 35, it says on Google, the cities of the Levites.
35 and what?
And 1.
Okay.
Numbers 35 and 1. And Yahweh spake unto Moses in the plains of Moab by Jordan near Jericho, saying, command the children of Israel that they give unto the Levites of the inheritance of their possessions cities to dwell in, and you shall give also unto the Levites suburbs for the cities round about them. In the cities shall they have to dwell in, and the suburbs of them shall be for their cattle, and for their goods, and for all their beasts. And the suburbs of the cities which you shall give unto the Levites shall reach from the wall of the city and outward 1,000 cubits round about. And you shall measure from without the city on the east side 2,000 cubits, and on the south side 2,000 cubits, and the west side 2,000 cubits. And on the north side 2,000 cubits, and the city shall be in the midst. This shall be to them the suburbs of the cities. And among the cities which you shall give unto the Levites.
That's good enough. Mm-hmm. All right, those are the 48 cities. Now, when you stop and think about it, if they give 48 cities, and the Israelites, the other 12 tribes, they get 12 portions of land. And so the cities are going to be scattered throughout the 12 inheritances. So 48 divided by 12, that would be 4 city in each inheritance.
Yeah.
So that each tribe would have access to a Levite city or have access to the Levites. Mm-hmm. If they wish to inquire something about the law or Yahweh, say, well, there's a Levitical city over here. We could ask the priests, we could ask these people about it, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you can go and try to. You had a question, Bud? Oh, I thought you had your hand up.
No.
Okay. The next set of passages it deals with the cities of refuge. But like if
six,
yeah, you know that six of those cities was set aside. Why don't you read that?
Numbers 35 and 6, and among the cities which you shall give unto the Levites, there shall be 6 cities for refuge, which you shall appoint for the manslayer, that he may flee thither, and to them you shall add 42 cities. So all the cities which you shall give to the Levites shall be 48 cities.
Mm-hmm.
Them shall you give with their suburbs. And the cities which you shall give shall be of the possession of the children of Israel. From them that have many, you shall give many. But from them that have few, you shall give few. Everyone shall give of his cities unto the Levites according to his inheritance that he inherited.
Okay. So now that's for that. Where's the extra mic at? The other mic.
The hand mic.
Yes, the hand mic.
On the stand.
Oh, there it is, behind me.
It's on the stand.
Which is where?
Straight.
Oh, I don't know. Okay, I couldn't see. Give it to Dr. Samuel, because I know this is his specialty about the manslaughter. If you would, you know, kind of go through it a couple of minutes, if you would.
Oh, I don't have no question.
Huh?
I didn't have a question.
Just explain it.
Ah,
explain it. Yeah, about the man, the manslayer, that, you know, he could go to the city. Yeah, just explain it.
Okay. When whoever slay or kill someone accidentally or on purpose, he had to go to a sanctuary, the closest one, mm-hmm. to be saved. Mm-hmm. And he can be saved the longest he is there, right there. If he go out, the relatives can kill him with no punishment and a revenge. But if the high priest of that time died, he was allowed to go out free and nobody can touch him. Mm. That's the sanctuary cities.
Okay. Okay. All right, that's, yeah, and you can read that, and that's, that was one of the 613 ordinances there. Okay, so as far as, now that's where the priests, you know, they were supplied by the other 10 tribes because they have contributed toward this tabernacle. And that didn't mean that the priests were, you know, it was like a form of welfare or something, because they, you know, they had their skills too. You know, some of them were farmers and things like that, or, you know, craftsmen and stuff. It's just that the bulk of it was the supply for this temple. Because, see, you have to remember, this was a continual sacrifice. In other words, they did this like pretty much around the clock. Talking about a continual sacrifice. So if it was a continual sacrifice, then they had to have a continual supply of animals to sacrifice. Okay. So as far as the big day, as far as the Day of Atonement, see, they had their own set of animals that they could choose from. Of course, the parameters were still the same. It had to be without spot, without blemish, so forth and so on. It couldn't have been something, you know, lamed up or something like that. You know, they had to choose the best. See, and on that day, they had to get a lamb, two goats, and a ram, okay? Mm-hmm. So the...
An ox.
Huh? Oh, bullocks, I'm sorry, yeah, the bullocks, I misspoke. Yeah, a bullock. Yeah, the lamb, the bullock. The ram. A ram, two goats,
and a bullock.
Okay, we got that. Okay, the bullock was for the priest, because he was there as the beast of burden. Okay, the two goats, one goat was for the sins of the people. That was sacrificed. Another goat was a scapegoat, by which a fit man would take the goat after they would pray on it. You know, they would take the sins and pray over the goat, and a fit man, that is to say, somebody who was kind of hardy, you know, would take him out from the camp into as far as he could into the wilderness and just let it go. And then the ram was for the cleansing of the sanctuary because it was polluted after so many, you know, because of sin sacrifice. So it had to be cleansed as well. Okay? This is the blood the high priest. There is a bigger illustration. This is what the high priest had to bring in three trips into the mount. Okay? Into the most holy place, which is like the three trips into the mount, that you just think about it. Mm-hmm. Because Yahshua had to fulfill this. See, it was always used to be a controversy about what the high priest wore when he performed his duties. And even to this day, you know, you can find some disagreements, you know, because what he wore. Now, we have him depicted right here, the high priest. He's wearing linen garments, just plain linen garments, okay? Whereas here, he has on the garments of beauty and glory, the breastplate, the ephod, all right, the mitre, yeah, the ephod, the pomegranates and the bells and so forth. I mean, he's dressed up. Okay, now, from what I've understood, this is what I've understood as far as how he dressed for the three trips up into this most holy place. The first time he went up, he was only wearing, the first time he went up, he took up the bullock, the blood of the bullock, because he had to, he had to offer blood for himself. That was for him, because he was a beast of burden as far as doing this day in, day out. So he had to offer the blood first of the bullock. And he went up here in linen garments. And he went up here on the side through the veil. And then he had to come in between the Ark of the Covenant, because it had staves in it. And he had to get in between the staves. And by getting in between the staves, he could move the staves around. He could turn it around. See, because it was on a swivel. And somebody would say, well, that's not in the Bible. How do you know it was on a swivel? Well, if I understand the human body, which is likened to your neck region here, your neck is on a swivel, because, I mean, it swivels about too, really. Right. See? So he does this, and so then when he goes around the circle, he can't turn his back on Yahweh. He can't turn his back on this. And so when he does this, and he comes back out on this side of the veil, he comes back out, and then he has to go back down and get the other blood. Comes back up, gets some coals off the altar of incense again, put it on, that's where he's got the censer. And on the second trip, he's coming up there with the blood of the goat. And he's still wearing linen garments. And he comes up from behind the veil, and he does the same thing. Figure eight up here, comes from behind the veil, goes back down here, and back down. And then the last trip is the blood of the ram, which is for the cleansing of the sanctuary. Now he comes up. This time he puts on the garments of beauty and glory. Mm-hmm. That is to say, he puts on the mitre, the ephod, the breastplate, you know, the pomegranates, the bells, and all. I mean, he's dressed up. And so then he goes up here behind the veil and he does the same thing. It's a figure eight, flicks the blood seven times, mind you. Each time he goes up, he's flicking the blood seven times. And then he comes back out. And then this time he's got the censer in his hand. When he comes back out, this time he throws the censer to the ground and he declares, it is finished. And he comes out. Now, the question you want to ask is, how do you know that? Okay. And this is what I've understood, what Dr. Kelly has always said about this vision. That the thing you have to look at, everything is correlated or correlated. Mm-hmm. Now, I mentioned earlier that it was kind of a slip of the tongue about Yahshua's three trips into the mount, which is a fulfillment of Moses' three trips into the mount.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Play 29, 30, and 31. Because Moses made three trips up into this mount. The first time he went up, he was told to get the people, have the people gather around. Okay, and Yahweh was going to speak to them. He told them to clean up, not to come against their wives, you know, the spouses for 3 days. Clean up. Don't touch this mountain. Don't let the beast touch this mountain. There was a barrier there. And Yahweh would speak to them. All right. Now we have here Yahshua. Because see, because Yahshua's mission is to fulfill. See, he's fulfilling. Now, jot and tittle. And when we say he's fulfilling jot and tittle, that means he's fulfilling 4,000 years of people, places, and things of what's written in the Old Testament. Okay? So now, not only is he fulfilling, in the space of 33 and a half years, which I say is a monumental task, when you stop and think about that. Okay? So now, I have these three plates specifically outlined here because these three plates is an illustration of Yahshua going up into a mount. This is the Sermon on the Mount. This is the Mount of Transfiguration. This is Mount Olivet. And these three represents Yahshua fulfilling Moses' three trips into the mount.
Yeah.
See? Here. Yahshua here. The migratory check involved here. Yeah. Okay. is the migratory trek, is the tabernacle pattern. Okay, now, let's just look at this. Here's Yahshua. I'm just going to, I'm not going to really delve into it all, because I want to just show the point of the three trips into the mount. Here, Yahshua's a prepared sacrificial body. He's drawn out, just like that lamb down here. Just draw a line here. Just like that lamb down here in Egypt was drawn out, all right? It was drawn out on the 10th, held over to the 14th, and killed between the two evenings. It was drawn out, just like Yahshua was drawn out, 3.5 years in his ministry, okay? He's drawn out. Then Yahshua goes to John the Baptist here. John the Baptist identifies him, and he's baptized in water, okay? Well, I just draw a line. And see, the whole world is represented in Yahshua, so they baptize unto John, you know, in the cloud, because see, there's this dove here, you know, which represents the spirit of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. I'll just draw a line over here at the Red Sea. Here's the Israelites, they're baptized in the cloud and in the sea unto Moses. Okay, just like the whole earth and Yahshua is baptized unto John. Okay, and in the spirit of the dove came and baptized and, you know, immersed Yahshua. It's the same thing in principle, all right? And so now Yahshua's up here. He's 40 days in the wilderness. Let's pick it up from there. Matthew 4:1.
Then was Yahshua led up of the Spirit into the wilderness, mm-hmm, to be tempted of the devil.
Uh-huh.
And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights.
Now see, he fasted 40 days, 40 nights. Why? Let's draw a line. How long were the Israelites in Canaan, in the wilderness?
40 years.
Mm-hmm. The reason why they were there 40 years, because if you remember, they sent 12 spies into Canaan's land.
Mm-hmm.
And they spied out the land for 40 days. And when they came back, 10 came back with an unfavorable report, mm-hmm, that the Israelites believed, as opposed to the 2 spies that came back with a favorable one. Mm-hmm. So because the Israelites believed the unfavorable report, Yahweh punished them a day for a year. So the 40 days that they spent spying out the land, mm-hmm, ended up being 40 years punishment. The Israelites are out here in the wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
That's Yahshua fulfilling that out here by being tempted by the adversary for 40 days.
Yeah.
A day for a year. See, because he's out here in the wilderness of Judea. Okay? Keep reading.
And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward hungry.
Uh-huh.
And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the son of God, of Elohim, command that these stones be made bread.
Now see, now when he said that, these weren't just some little rocks just hanging around. Mm-hmm. See, these were stones that were landmarks, to draw a line. They were landmarks because when, keep your finger there, I think it's Joshua, the 4th chapter?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. I believe, I believe it's Joshua, the 4th chapter?
Yeah, first.
Mm-hmm. Is it?
I think so.
For the priest which bear the ark? Joshua 4 and 4. 4.
4:4.
Then Joshua called the 12 men, whom he had prepared of the children of Israel, out of every tribe a man. And Joshua said unto them, pass over before the ark of Yahweh your Elohim,
mm-hmm,
into the midst of Jordan,
mm-hmm,
and take you up every man of you a stone upon his shoulder.
A stone, see, because when they could see the Jordan River divided, just like the Red Sea did, and in the midst of the division, Joshua told the men to take you, 12 men representative of the 12 tribes, pick ye up a stone.
Yeah.
Read.
A stone upon his shoulder, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel,
uh-huh,
that this may be a sign among you, that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean ye by these stones?
Mm-hmm.
Then ye shall answer them, that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of Yahweh. When it passed over Jordan, the waters of Jordan were cut off. And these stones shall be for a memorial unto the children of Israel forever.
Okay. Now that's the stone. That's the stones that the serpent is telling Yahshua, well, if you're hungry enough, turn these stones into bread.
Yeah.
See, now go back to where we were at.
Matthew 4 and 3.
Uh-huh.
And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the son of Yahweh, command that these stones be made bread.
We just read that. These stones that Joshua, let's put it real succinctly. The stones that you, Yahshua, ordered your men to take up out of the Jordan, because the same Yahshua back then is the same Yahshua that Satan's talking to now.
Mm-hmm.
So he's telling us that, well, if you're hungry enough, why don't you turn into bread the stones that you told your men to take up out of this Jordan River?
Yeah.
But what?
But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone.
Man shall not live by bread alone, read.
But by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of Yahweh.
Now, see, now look here. Look where we're at. Because, see, we're here according to this plate. This is called baptism and ministry. Court roundabout, holy place, most holy place. We have Satan and Yahshua here. Controversy in the wilderness of Judea. They're in the holy place. And we're talking about bread. Why are we talking about bread? Draw a line. See, in the holy place in the wilderness of Sinai, wasn't there manna given in heaven?
Yes.
I mean, manna come down from heaven to feed them.
Mm-hmm.
In the tabernacle pattern, isn't there a table of shewbread?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
See, it's the principles we look for. Mm-hmm. In all of these stories. And Yahshua is fulfilling all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was instituted in the law, spoke about in the testimony or the prophecy, then he is going to fulfill that. And then bring it into a spiritual reality. Here, this is the spiritual reality. Because he just said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of Yahweh. That's what we got. That's what this says here. Words of Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
Right here. And it's in the same position as the table of shewbread.
Yeah.
As the scripture says, I think it's somewhere in the Proverbs or Psalms, it says the ear tasteth words as the mouth tasteth, you know, the ear cheweth words as the mouth tasteth food. See, it's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
All right, keep reading.
In Matthew?
Yes.
Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on the pinnacle of the
uh-huh.
temple and saith unto him, if thou be the son of Yahweh, cast thyself down,
mm-hmm.
for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee,
mm-hmm.
and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone.
Now here he is. Now this is the thing that when I first realized that tripped me out. The devil is quoting scripture to Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
He's quoting scripture to him.
Yeah.
Because the scripture he's quoting, what's he quoting? He's quoting Psalms.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't he? He's quoting the Psalms?
Yeah, 91.
Let's read that. Yeah, Psalms 91 and 11.
Psalms 91 and 11.
Mm-hmm.
For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways.
Uh-huh.
Now, they
go ahead.
They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone.
Now, why is he saying that? Now, he's quoting scripture, sure enough.
Mm-hmm.
And see, and the scripture, let's put this in perspective. It's from the Psalms. And see, and we know that the prophets, the books from Joshua to Malachi represents the testimony. And everything they have to say is drawn out from what Moses wrote.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So now, for David to even write that, because it's really a song, it's part of a song, also, for him to write that, he had to draw out something that Moses wrote. So we draw a line here. He says, he shall do what about his angel? Read that first part about the angel. Just read 11 again.
For he shall give his angels charge over thee,
uh-huh.
to keep thee in all thy ways.
Wasn't back here, they followed a phenomenal cloud. Wasn't there an angel in the cloud?
That's right.
That kept them in their way?
Mm-hmm.
You understand my point?
Mm-hmm.
See, for David to write that, he has to draw out from something Moses wrote.
Mm-hmm.
And what Moses wrote was Exodus 23 and 20. See, and the devil's saying that, see, he's just bringing it up because he don't know it. He's just bringing, because see, we can see it, that this is all, everything's got to be fulfilled. It's got to be fulfilled. So the devil bringing this up is just helping in the fulfillment, you know, whether he realizes it or not. But see, yeah, read Exodus.
Exodus 23:20.
Uh-huh.
Behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in the way,
mm-hmm.
and to bring thee into the place where I have prepared.
Uh-huh.
Beware of him, and obey his voice. Provoke him not, for he will not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him.
Okay. See, now that's, see, all of that comes into play just when we're looking at this plate here.
Yeah.
See, just what's happening here. Okay, now go back to Matthew.
7:4-7, Yahshua said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt Yahweh thy Elohim.
Uh-huh.
Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world,
mm-hmm.
and the glory of them,
mm-hmm.
and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me.
You know, this guy's truly a smooth character, mm-hmm. you know, because he's taking all this stuff, I mean, he's quoting the scripture, because see, he's talking to the one, as we said,
mm-hmm.
he is talking to the one that told, back here, that told his men to pick up the rocks out of the Jordan River.
Yeah.
He's talking to the one that told David what to write in the Psalms.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And now he's talking to the one, because he said, now if you bow down and worship me, I'll give you all these kingdoms. He's talking to the one that gave him all these kingdoms in the first place.
Yeah.
See, because the kingdoms are the way we have them right here. That's what Lucifer is showing. He said, when he shows him the kingdoms of the world, this is what he's showing him.
Yeah.
All of this, see. Which Yahshua gave to him.
Yeah.
But he said, well, I'll give this to you, you know, if you still not worship me.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, the dude is too smooth, ain't he?
Yeah.
Too bold. That's bold. Mm-hmm. Okay? But read.
Matthew?
Yes.
10. Then said Yahshua unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship Yahweh thy Elohim, and him only shalt thou serve.
Uh-huh.
Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him.
Angels came and ministered. Why? Just draw a line back here. Because
mm-hmm.
there was an angel back here that ministered unto Moses. That was Joshua. That was his. Joshua was Moses' minister.
Right.
Okay. See, everything is correlatable. See? And Yahshua's fulfilling jot and tittle, okay? Keep reading.
Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Now when Yahshua had heard that John was cast into prison,
mm-hmm.
he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the seacoast, in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which is written by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee, and of the Gentiles. The people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up.
Oh, now, why would he say that?
I don't know.
Remember where we're at on this plate. See, we're looking at this plate here, baptism and ministry, plate 29. And we're going in an ascending fashion here. And so now he's talking about light has sprung up. Where are we at according to the plate? This is the holy place, right?
Yeah.
Let's just draw a line, right? In the wilderness of Sinai, which is the holy place, on the migratory trek, they had light in the wilderness,
that's
right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night.
Yeah.
In the tabernacle pattern, in the holy place, you got this lampstand. That's the light there,
mm-hmm.
okay? Everything that Yahshua's doing is jot and tittle, he's fulfilling, but also he's going according to a tabernacle pattern.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's what these plates are depicting him, showing you according to the tabernacle pattern, and that he is the law of the Spirit in operation. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Keep reading.
17. From that time Yahshua began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for mm-hmm. they were fishers.
Mm-hmm.
And he saith unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.
Mm-hmm.
And they straightway left him their nets and followed him. And going on from thence, he saw other two brethren, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, in the ship with Zebedee their father, mending their nets, and he called them. And they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. And Yahshua went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with diverse diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had the palsy, and he healed them. And there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee, and from Decapolis, and from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan.
Okay, from beyond the Jordan. In other words, from the other side of the Jordan. In other words, multitudes followed Yahshua from beyond the Jordan. They followed him. Why? Draw a line. Wasn't there a multitude that followed Joshua, the son of Nun, in the Canaan's land?
Right.
It's the same thing. Yahshua's fulfilling that. Okay? So multitudes followed Yahshua, the son of Nun, back here. And that's fulfilled by Yahshua having multitudes following him. Okay? Continue.
Chapter 5. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying...
Okay, now he went up into a mountain and he was set. Why? Because, see, this is a fulfillment of the cloud that led the Israelites out of Egypt. When they came to Mount Sinai, this cloud went up on top of Mount Sinai and set. See? So, Yahshua here, the Sermon on the Mount, this is a fulfillment of Moses' first trip into the Mount.
Right.
Okay? Keep reading.
3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Now, these are the so-called Beatitudes. Okay? And remember, Yahshua's fulfilling. So if he's fulfilling, what he's fulfilling is that which is in the law and the prophets, or what Moses wrote and what the prophets wrote. So now, read that again.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Now, see, now blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because back here, these Israelites who were poor in spirit, see, you know, they were poor in spirit, but theirs was this inheritance up here, this Canaan's land. That was a type, yeah. Kingdom of heaven. See, that's the type back here. Okay, read.
4. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted.
See, now back here, the Israelites, they were in bondage and they mourned. But Yahweh came and delivered them by a mighty hand, and they were comforted. They were delivered out of that state, out of that state and condition down here in Egypt. Read.
Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
Now, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Now, Moses was the meekest man to walk the face of the earth. And when he was up here in this cloud, he was shown the vision of the heavens and the earth. So here's Moses, the meekest man to ever walk, inheriting the earth. See, other people think it means, you know that, oh, you gotta be humble and stuff, and you'll get a plot of land or something. I don't know. No, Yahshua's fulfilling that which is written in the law and the prophets. And so you have to go back to the law and the prophets to understand what Yahshua was doing. Okay, read.
Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled.
See, that's what happened back here. See, from the natural, they were physically hungry, and all. Yahweh took care of them. He gave them manna from heaven, quail, water from the rock. See, he fed them, he took care of them. The clothes didn't wear out for 40 years, so forth and so on. Read.
But this is thirst after righteousness.
Yeah.
And they're fed to eat.
Yeah.
That makes them righteous.
No. They were. It's just a type. Just as you are hungry, and we want to eat something dinner, we hunger after the spiritual. Our souls hunger after true spiritual food. We're just looking at a type and shadow back here. That's all. We're just taking types and shadows to understand spiritual principles, that's all. See, because the Israelites back here, truth be told, all of them died back here.
Yeah.
603,550, see, they died back here because of unbelief.
Yeah.
But it was that new birth, see, that 144,000 that was born out of that Joshua took over. And see, nobody knew that number until John on the Isle of Patmos called it out. And when he called it out, he said, yeah, there was 144,000. Why 144,000? Well, it was 12 tribes. It was 12,000 of each tribe. But then as he goes on, he said, but then I saw a multitude that no man could number that came across. See, Yahshua back here, when he was walking the earth plane, he had multitudes following him. And he's going along, and he's fulfilling. That's why I pointed back here. There was a multitude back here that followed Joshua, the son of Nun, into Canaan's land. Yahshua was fulfilling that. It's still happening to this day. There are multitudes following Yahshua Messiah today. It's just in the spirit. See, you look around and say, oh, well, I only see like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you know, people. I mean, I said, yeah, but you forgot to count Michael and Gabriel and a numerous host of angels. You forgot about them. See, I think all that constitutes a multitude.
Yeah.
See, okay? See, that's the thing we're looking at. We try to look at the spirit. Yeah, we're stuck here in this mundane, but we look at the natural to try to understand the spiritual principle to it. That's all. Okay? I need to get something else here. We're in the fifth chapter. Yeah, we need to expedite this. You know what I mean, Joe?
21.
Thank you. Yeah, because I can go through the Beatitude. Yeah, let's just keep going through the Beatitude. Come on.
Let's, okay.
Yeah, might as well. Might as well, since I'm here. Just,
now we're on 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see Yahweh.
No, you missed one.
7?
You missed one.
Verse 7.
Well, it's verse 7. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
Now, blessed are the merciful. Now, what happened? Because remember, the Israelites messed up, and Moses went up here to try to obtain mercy. Mm-hmm. And Yahweh said, well, I'll blot whoever I want out of my book, because he was the book of life up here.
Yeah.
And so Yahweh extended mercy upon whom he wanted to extend mercy to. He extended mercy unto Moses, not so much to the other 603,550 that came up out of here. Okay. Read.
Blessed are the poor in heart, pure in heart, for they shall see Yahweh.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see Yahweh. Well, Moses was pure in heart in the sense that he was born with the Holy Spirit. Now, of course, he himself, was under Adam's transgression like everybody else. But the Holy Spirit in him, Yahweh allowed him up here to see, to see Elohim up here. And he did see him, because he described it to him, the body, a feet, hands. He saw him. All right, read.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of Yahweh.
Okay, now blessed are the peacemakers. Well, see, now back here, the peacemaker was Joshua, son of Nun. Because like whenever they had a problem, they would go get Joshua and say, look, Josh, we got Amalek and his boys, they're causing a ruckus outside the camp, They're disturbing the peace.
Mm-hmm.
So if you would, you think you can get some guys together and go out here and handle this problem? And so Joshua said, no problem. Hey, buckle on your swords. And he got the swords, and they went out there, and they handled it. They killed. And when the last Amalekite fell, peace had been restored. Because Joshua was the peacemaker.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, whenever they had a problem. Okay, well, we do the same thing. Somebody's disturbing your peace. What do? You call the popos, right? And they come on and, hey, you're making too much noise. You need to stop it. That kind of thing. Yeah. See, people, get out there. I know where I live at. I live near the federal building, and a lot of times when there's certain controversies come up, people will get out there and protest. And I know when there's a protest because I see people walking on my street, more than usual. And I say, wait a minute, there's a whole lot of people walking on this street. I say, must be a protest going on, because I see a lot of folks walking on my street. Yeah. And so every now and then, if I'm curious, I may get on my bicycle, and I'll just ride around it. It's like about maybe 3 or 4 blocks, and I'll ride around it to see what it is. And sure enough, it'll be a throng of people out there in front of the federal building. They're screaming and got signs and stuff, and they're blocking traffic, and the police have to come out there. All right, get off the street. You got the right to protest, but you don't have the right to block traffic. Get off the street, they're the ones to cause order, And if you disturb them too much, then they'll pull out the clubs and, to live with their own kind of peace, But that's the peacemaker. Joshua said it was the peacemaker. Okay, keep reading.
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake.
See, now these folks were persecuted because they were surrounded by warring nations, talking about the Israelites when they were out here in the wilderness of Sinai. See, they were surrounded by warring nations. Okay, go ahead.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. See, but still, they were going to get to Canaan's land, which is a type of the kingdom of heaven, the promised land. Okay, read.
Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be
exceeding. Yeah, that's what happened. Because see, they were out there, let's see, who was it? The story of Balaam, that's what I'm thinking of. He was a hireling prophet. A king hired Balaam and said, look, you see these people out there, these Hebrews, these Israelites, or whatever, you know, they just put a curse on these folks, if you would, you know. And he was going to do that until Yahweh came to him and visited him. And instead of putting a curse on him, he put a blessing on him. Now, you know, you ever read the story of Balaam, you know, that's the story, you know, the famous story where his beast spoke to him.
Yeah.
You know, his ass talked to him, see. And that's what they say, the donkey, or what you want to say, spoke to him. You know, that's where people get the term, you know, you're an ass, you're a lying ass, or something like that. That's what people would say, you're a lying ass.
Yeah.
And that's what they mean by that. You know, you're an ass, you're an ass that can speak, but even though, which is a miracle in itself, but you're lying. That kind of thing. But the angel that visited Balaam, I'll say this about the angel that visited Balaam. A lot of people think that was Michael or Gabriel, but that wasn't. That was Joshua's son of Nun. Because see, he said that angel had a sword in his hand. See that angel was, remember we read in Exodus 23:20, said there was an angel in the cloud and he was, and it do not provoke him.
Right.
Well, Balaam provoked the angel. Mm-hmm. And the angel came and paid him a visit, and see, and he was out standing with the sword, and Balaam didn't see him, but his donkey did, his ass saw him, and that's why she did what she did. Because he provoked the angel, and he was there. He said, okay, I'm here to deal with you. See, that was Joshua's son. And see, and what happened was, oh gosh, let's read. I didn't really step to it now. Because we almost do with that.
Numbers.
It's in Numbers.
22,
22. Somebody get that, and let's finish this up, our fifth chapter. 5:21. And then we'll go to Numbers.
You have heard that it was said by them of old time,
Thou
shalt not commit murder.
Mm-hmm.
For whosoever committeth murder shall be in danger of the court of justice.
Now that's what Joshua said on the Sermon on the Mount. Why? Because, see, this is a fulfillment of Moses' first trip. That's when the cloud spoke down from Mount Sinai. One of the things he said, thou shalt not commit murder.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Read the other one.
27.
Verse 27.
Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery.
Now that's what Joshua said on the Sermon on the Mount. Why? Because it's a fulfillment of what Yahweh said in the cloud down to the Israelites. Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? See, that's Joshua fulfilling Moses' first trip into the mount. Just as he's speaking from the mount, the cloud back here is speaking from the mount to the Israelites that are assembled here. Is there another one?
I
think it's like 32 or 33. Something. 33.
Again, you've heard that it's been said by them of old time, thou shalt not swear to a lie, but shall make as unto Yahweh thine oaths.
Like I said, see, now that was back here, it was said, thou shalt not commit falsehood. See, Joshua fulfilled that. See, that's all part of the first trip into the mount. Okay, now we can get the other thing, just a side thing about Balaam and the angel.
Numbers 22:21. And Balaam rose up in the morning and saddled his ass and went with the princes of Moab. And Yahweh's anger was kindled because he went. And the angel of Yahweh stood in the way for an adversary against him.
Now the angel of Yahweh, see? The angel of Yahweh stood in the way. What angel of Yahweh is that? That's Joshua, son of Nun. Because he was out there that's the only angel out there in the wilderness. Because we read it in Exodus.
Yeah.
that he was the angel in the cloud and my name is in him. So now how's he appearing to Balaam? He's astral projecting from the Israelites' camp to Balaam. Mm-hmm. And he's standing there because remember we said in Exodus, he said, don't provoke this angel. Well, Balaam was going to try to put a curse on Israel. And that provoked the angel. And so that's why the angel is there. Read.
Now he was riding upon his ass, and mm-hmm. his two servants were with him. And the ass saw the angel of Yahweh standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand. And the ass turned aside out of the way and went into the field. And Balaam smote the ass to turn her into the way. Mm-hmm. But the angel of Yahweh stood in the path of the vineyards, a wall being on this side and a wall on that side. And when the ass saw the angel of Yahweh, she thrust herself unto the wall and crushed Balaam's foot against the wall, and he smote her again. And the angel of Yahweh went further and stood in a narrow place where there was no way to turn either to the right hand or to the left. And when the ass saw the angel of Yahweh, she fell down under Balaam, and Balaam's anger was kindled, and he smote the ass with a staff. And Yahweh opened the mouth of the ass, and she said unto Balaam, what have I done unto thee that thou hast smitten me these three times? And Balaam said unto the ass, because thou hast mocked me, I would there with the sword in mine hand, for now would I kill thee. And the ass said unto Balaam, am not I thine ass, upon which thou hast ridden ever since I was thine unto this day? Was I ever wont to do so unto thee? And he said, nay. Then Yahweh opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of Yahweh standing in the way, mm-hmm. and his sword drawn in his hand, and he bowed down his head and fell flat on his face. And the angel of Yahweh said unto him, wherefore hast thou smitten thine ass these three times? Behold, I went out to withstand thee, because the way is perverse before me. And the ass saw me and turned from me these three times. Unless she had turned firm from me, surely not also I had slain thee and saved her alive. And Balaam said unto the angel of Yahweh, I have sinned, for I knew not that thou stoodest in the way against me. Now therefore, if it displease thee, I will get me back again. And the angel of Yahweh said unto Balaam, go with the men, but only the word that I shall speak unto thee, that thou shalt speak. So Balaam went with the princes of Balak.
Okay. Now, I just wanted to read that just to show that one beatitude where it said, people shall revile you. Well, that's what happened back in the Israelites. See, Balaam was a hireling prophet, hired to put a curse on him. Mm-hmm. And Joshua, son of Nun, he saw that and just said, no, you're not going to do that. You ain't going to do that, mm-hmm. you know. Okay? Now, once again, play 29. This is Sermon on the Mount. Joshua's fulfilling Moses' first trip into the Mount. Okay? Play 30. Miracles and Transfiguration. Here again, this is a prepared sacrificial body. Joshua, he is the prepared sacrificial body. Okay? Coming in, you know, as Dr. Kinley would say, with blood running warm in his veins. Okay? And so now here, this is during his ministry. We got these folks out here in the boat. Maybe we should read that. Matthew 8:23.
And when he was entered in, into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, and so much that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Rabbi, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, why are you fearful, O ye of little faith?
Mm-hmm.
Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea,
mm-hmm.
and there was a great calm.
Mm-hmm.
But the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? And when he was come to the other side into the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with devils.
Okay, now hold it. Now, let's look at this. We got this illustration here of Yahshua and the boys. They're in the boat, you know, waters. And Yahshua speaks to the wind and the waves. You know, and they obeyed him. We got this dove here, or the spirit, or the law of the spirit. they recognize who Yahshua is, because Yahshua is the same law of the Spirit that was there at their inception. So they knew who he was. Talking about the wind and the waves, the elements, all, they know who he is. He's the creator. Hmm. Okay? Now, which is a body of water, which draw a line to the migratory tract that brings you to the Red Sea. Also brings you to the brains of labor here in the tabernacle pattern. Hmm. Now, as Yahshua and the boys come to the shore, Yahshua gets off, and then he goes up and read that scripture again.
Matthew 8:28. And when he was come to the other side into the country of the Gergesenes, there met he two possessed with demons coming out of the tomb.
So now these two were possessed with demons coming out of the tomb. In other words, he had to pass by these two men possessed with demons. Why? Draw a line. Here at the Red Sea. See, there were mountains on either side that the Israelites had to pass through to go through the sea. All right, continue.
Exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way. And behold, they cried out, saying, "What have we to do? What have we to do with thee, Yahshua, thou son of Yahweh? Art thou come hither to torment us before the set time?" And there was a good way off from them a herd of many swine feeding. So the demons besought him, saying, "If thou cast us out, permit us to go away into the herd of swine." And he said unto them, "Go." And when they were come out, they went into the herd of swine, and behold, the whole herd of swine ran violently down a steep place into the sea and perished in the water.
Now, why did they do that? Why did they do that? We have a pattern. Let's draw a line. Here's the migratory pattern. When the Red Sea divided up and opened up, the Israelites, they walked through on dry ground, correct? What happened to the Egyptians? They went into the Red Sea and the Red Sea swallowed them up, or they drowned in the Red Sea. That's a fulfillment, see, that's being fulfilled here. See, with these pigs, see, they ran violently into the sea. That's what happened to the Egyptians. They ran violently into the Red Sea. It's the same thing. See, that's why I can look at the chart and just draw a line and see the correlation with that. Okay? Now, we go on, and it has, in the holy place here, we have ministry and miracles. It has Matthew 4:23 here. Let's just might as well just read it, see what it says.
Matthew 4:23. And Yahshua went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with diverse diseases and torments, and those that were possessed with devils.
Okay, that's good enough. Now, also in his miracles, we know about the story where he fed a multitude with five fishes and two loaves of bread. And had bread, you know, the bread. And that's part of the miracle of his miracles and ministry. That's bread here. Draw a line. See, just like they had manna in the wilderness. It's like this bread here on the table of shewbread. All right. We have this illustration here of Lazarus being raised from the dead. That's John 11 chapter, 11:41. Let's read that. See, because what we all look for are principles on these plates. This tabernacle pattern has seven steps. First step is the gate. Second step is the altar of sin sacrifice with the principle of blood. Third step is the brazen laver of water, which is the principle of burial or washing and regeneration. The fourth step is the door, where you have the cup of holy and holy oil, typifying spirit. The fifth step of the holy place is the holy place. And the principles here, you have a 40 principle. You also have a principle of the light, the bread, and the intercessor. The sixth step is this departmental veil, the second veil. this departmental veil between holy place and most holy place of blue, purple, and scarlet, typifying the veil of the flesh. Seventh step is the Ark of the Covenant with the two archangels on top of a mercy seat where the cloud sat on. Wherein you had the table of stones, pot of manna, and Aaron's rod that budded into almonds. These are principles that you remember from the pattern and the migratory pattern. Because the correlation between these two plates and the principles therein are the same principles you're going to use in every plate that you see in this room. Because it's the same thing. It's the pattern being operated. It's the law of the Spirit in operation. In the holy place of each plate, you're going to look for the light, the bread, the intercessor, and the principle of 40. And that's going to be in all of the holy places. The most holy place is a type of heaven. See? Mm-hmm. Down here you have a bloodline. You have a water line. You have a spirit line. The cloud. When you understand these principles and keep them in mind, then there isn't anything about the Bible you will not, you know, not understand, because it's all the same. Even the stories that we don't have illustrated, you can, if you look at them hard enough, you'll see them going according to the pattern. You'll see it. Okay? Lazarus.
John 11:9.
I know I did call it, didn't I?
Yeah.
11:41, was it?
John 11:41. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Yahshua lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth.
Okay, now he called forth, he called Lazarus by name.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and Lazarus came forth. And I've often heard the story that if he had just said, come forth, because he was standing in front of a cemetery.
Mm-hmm.
If he had just said, come forth, then everybody would have got up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
See? But he had to call him by name.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Let's look at the pattern.
Yeah.
He had to call him by name. Come back here. Let's look over here. We're in the holy place. Remember, Moses made three trips up into the mount. During one of his trips, he was also told about the, let's see, where's that at? Help me, I think it's in Numbers, Joe, where's it at? About the book of life, about the book? Blot me out of this book.
Exodus 32.
Yeah,
32. 32,
start with 30.
Okay. Exodus 32:30. And it came to pass on the morrow that Moses said unto the people, you have sinned a great sin, and now I will go up unto Yahweh, peradventure I shall make an atonement for your sin. And Moses returned unto Yahweh and said, oh, this people have sinned a great sin, and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book which thou hast written.
Now see, that says, blot me out of thy book which thou hast written. Now for him to say that, it would mean that Moses' name is written in the book.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
See, keep reading.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book.
Now, him will I blot out of my book. In other words, everybody's name is written in the book of life.
Mm.
But if you're not, but if you reject Yahshua, then your name will be blotted out of that book. But if you accept Yahshua, then you'll be called by your name.
Very good.
That's what happened to Lazarus. He was called by his name. Don't we say it all the time? Yahshua called him by name, and he came alive and came forth. Draw a line. This is spiritual temple play. We say it all the time. You had a divine invitation to come here. And for you to have a divine invitation to come here, that meant that Yahweh called you by name.
Okay. Yeah.
For you to come here. He called you by name. And you, and look, we were just like Lazarus. Lazarus was dead. And Yahweh called him by his name, and he came back to life. Yahshua called you by name into this class. Mm-hmm. You were dead, and now you were brought back to life.
Very good. Yeah.
You're brought back to life. I'm pointing to this. Reason why I'm pointing to this, because see, this is the spiritual temple plate.
Yeah.
This is an illustration of the operation of the Holy Spirit in a vessel. And if I'm drawing a line into the holy place, mm-hmm. see, just like here, Moses, we just read that. See, he's up here in the mount. He's talking to Yahweh, and Yahweh said, well, look, him who sinned against me, him I'll blot out the book.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because his name is there. But you, Moses, you know, your name is in there. I call you by name. Just draw a line. He called Lazarus by name.
Yeah.
Call him by name. Just like you. He called you out by name.
That's right.
And like Lazarus, you came forth from the dead.
Yeah.
You came forth.
Excellent.
See? See? And where are we at? There's a scripture that says, I am the light. Where's that at? Is it the same chapter? John? I'm sorry. Go back to John. I'm sorry.
You mean the light shines in darkness?
Yeah.
11:25. John 11:25. Yahshua said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life.
Mm-hmm. That's what I want. That's what I want. Read 11:25.
That's what I'm reading.
Okay.
Yahshua said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live.
See, now he's the resurrection and the life, which is the same as saying he is the life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay? He is that. See, he's the light. And just like he's the light, just draw a line. It'd be like the lampstand in the holy place. See? And he's the intercessor, because he interceded between life and death for Lazarus in this instance here.
Yeah.
But he's the intercessor. See, wait, go back.
Go back where?
Go back to 11:41, just when he was about to raise Lazarus.
You talking about John?
John 11:41.
Oh, okay. John 11:41. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Yahshua lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee thou hast heard me.
And he's giving intercession. He's praying. He's giving intercession.
Right.
Why? Draw a line. The altar of incense.
Mm-hmm.
Intercession. He's praying. He's giving intercession. He's interceding for Lazarus. Just like he intercedes for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And the Father will hear him. Now, if we were standing out here, don't you think, wait a minute, let's just go back. Don't you think Martha and Mary, his sister, was praying their hearts out
mm-hmm.
for Lazarus to come back?
Yeah.
They were offering intercession. I'm talking about Mary and Martha, his sister.
Mm-hmm.
But did Yahweh hear them? No. Because he didn't bring Lazarus back. But then now here's Yahshua. Yahshua, he said, now Father, read that again.
Yahshua's. I don't see where it says Father.
Well, you were left off.
42.
And I knew that thou hearest them. Thou hearest me always, and because of the people that stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me.
Mm-hmm.
And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth.
Now he offered intercession,
mm-hmm.
and the Father heard him.
Yeah.
Because he said, Lazarus, come forth. Now, Mary and Martha couldn't do that. Don't you think they were offering intercession? All those other people, his friends out there, they were offering intercession too. Oh, Lord, please come back, Lazarus. Oh, Yahweh, please bring back our brother.
Yeah.
You know, and then nothing happened. But here's Yahshua. offering intercession. Here comes Lazarus. Mm-hmm. See, that's why. See, the father, why? Because the father hears him. Mm. The father will hear him and take his intercession into consideration. You and I, see, we'll ask for something stupid. Oh, can I get a new car, a new house, you know, new husband, new wife, you know, a new route to work, you know, some new money, you know, we ask a whole bunch of stuff,
yeah.
You know, that kind of stuff. Instead of asking for things that we really need, like an understanding,
mm-hmm.
you know, or wisdom and knowledge, you know, to understand, you know, this purpose, things, something that we really need, see. Because Yahweh said, if you ask for those things first, all the other things I'll take care of.
Yeah.
Now, so now that's light. Oh, here we are. Yeah. Light bread intercession in principle with Yahshua here. Okay, now let's go to the 17th chapter of Matthew quickly because I'm out of time.
First verse.
Yeah.
Matthew 17 and 1. And after 6 days, Yahshua taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart. And he was transfigured before them,
uh-huh.
and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then answered Peter and saith unto Yahshua, Sire, it is good for us to be here.
Mm-hmm.
If thou wilt, let us make here 3 tabernacles,
mm-hmm.
one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
Mm-hmm.
Hear ye him.
Okay, now, that's good enough. Now, normally when we do this correlation, we usually do it over here because it's pretty much depicted on the Moses chart, you know, the Mount of Transfiguration, because it's a direct fulfillment of Moses back here. Moses' second trip into the Mount. Okay, Moses' second trip into the Mount, that's where Yahweh showed him himself and showed him the tabernacle and the days of creation. He was up here 40 days entirely. 7 days for the creation, 33 days for the dimensions of this tabernacle. All right, while he's up here, Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu see him. Aaron is the elder, Nadab and Abihu are brothers, 70 elders. Here we have Peter, who was the elder of the disciples, James and John were brothers. Not long after this event, 70 were chosen to go out 2 by 2. But this is a fulfillment of this. Now, it's just that we have the same event on this plate. It's called Miracles and Transfiguration. And we're just looking at it according to the pattern. Yahshua transfiguring before Peter, James, and John, that would be him taking off the flesh. Because he took off the, because he was in a physical body. And then now he's in a glorified body. They see him in a glorified body. And they see Moses, who has the book of the law in his hand, Moses on one side, and Elijah on the other side, which is the prophet, or the testimony. So he's witnessed, here's Yahshua, witnessed by the law and the prophet. See, and see, I can just draw a line. That's just like here in the tabernacle. The cloud sat on the mercy seat, see, witnessed by Michael and Gabriel. Okay? All right? So now, that's... And see, this is the second, this is Yahshua fulfilling Moses. Now, Yahshua had been up in the mountains more than 3 times. But these are the 3 specific times that we're pointing out to show you that this is him fulfilling Moses' 3 trips into the mount. So now he's fulfilling that, you know, with this plate here, as we just showed you, in this Mount of Transfiguration, okay, Moses' second trip. Now, to fulfill Moses' 3rd trip, we go through his death, his burial, his resurrection, tarried on earth for 40 days, and then he ascended from the Mount of Olivet. Mm-hmm. Now this is Moses, this is a fulfillment of Moses' 3rd trip into the Mount.
Yeah.
Now this is pretty straightforward, we don't have much time. But now here's the death of Yahshua. He's on the cross, and we just draw a line, because we showed you here, but the other place, he was a prepared sacrificial body. All right? And then now here comes the time when he has to be put to death. All right? And it's just like down here with Egypt, with the Passover lamb, okay? Here we got the soldier. He's getting ready to pierce him in the side, drain the blood, just like down here in Egypt. The lamb had to be drained. No bones could be broken here, just like no bones could be broken here. You have 4 points of blood. See the crown of thorns, the hands, and the feet. You have 4 points of blood over here. But the Israelites putting the blood on it on the doorpost, on the inside of the doorpost. Okay? And then Yahshua was buried in Joseph's new tomb, all right? And then they put a watch over it. And then it was the angel that rolled the tomb away. Just like back here with the Red Sea. See, Moses stood at the Red Sea and said, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh. Or in other words, stand still and see Yahshua. Mm-hmm. And Yahshua was telling him, he said, look, just raise your rod up, Moses, and let the children proceed forth. And so Moses did that, and the Red Sea divided, and the children went forward. Now, it wasn't Moses that did that. It was Joshua, the son of Nun, that did that. But the Israelites thought it was Moses, because all they saw was the rod lifting up.
Yeah.
See, but it was Joshua, the son of Nun, that rolled, who was the angel in the cloud that rolled the seas back, you know, that perpetrated the conditions to roll the sea back. Just like over here, see, it was an angel back here that rolled the tombstone away to release Yahshua, you know. It was the angel back here that did that. Mm-hmm. All right, so now here's Yahshua. Let's get that. I think it's Mark 16:1. And so now, here's Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection. And so now he's resurrecting. Okay, so we want to see some principles here in this resurrection.
Mark 16:1. And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him.
Now, why would they bring sweet spices? Now, of course, he's dead, and it was a tradition that they would, you know, anoint the bodies. But there's a principle we're looking for.
Right.
They had sweet spices to anoint him. Now, this is in the holy place of this plate.
Right.
Let's just draw a line.
Incense.
It's the golden altar of incense.
Yeah.
See, because it was made up of spices and sweet spices and stuff. In fact, we had a thing about where they talked about those spices like myrrh and stuff like that. But that's the principle. See, because this is in the holy place of this plate, and so you want to see the principles of light, bread, intercession. So they're bringing spices. Why? Because the spice is here.
Mm-hmm.
Golden altar of incense. Okay? Keep reading.
2. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun.
Uh-huh.
And they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre?
And see, the first light of the sun, okay? Why the first light? Draw a line. See, here's the lampstand.
Oh.
And if you remember back here with the tabernacle, see?
Yeah.
See, remember back here in the wilderness, they followed a phenomenal cloud.
Mm-hmm.
It was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night.
Yeah.
And when the pillar of fire would come on at 3:00 in the evening, just when they would light this lampstand.
Mm-hmm.
At 3:00 in the evening, that's when the cloud would turn to a pillar of fire.
Okay.
And this lampstand would stay on for 18 hours till 9 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
the next morning when the sun would shine through the tabernacle, because when they set up this tabernacle, it always had to be facing east,
yeah,
toward the rising sun. So when the lampstand was put out at 9:00, the tabernacle, which was facing east, the sunlight would just shine right through the door into the sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
The light. So we just read that about the light. So here's the light principle here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now we got the spices and we got the light. Keep reading.
4. And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away,
mm-hmm,
for it was very great.
Mm-hmm.
And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment. And they were affrighted. And said unto them, be not affrighted. You seek Yahshua of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. But go your way, tell his disciples of Peter, that he goeth before you into Galilee.
Okay, that's good enough. Get Luke 23, 23 or 24, 27.
Luke 24:27. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
Now, this was during the 40 days he tarried. He was on the road to Emmaus with these guys, and they were like, oh, stranger, you ain't been around. You don't know what happened, man. Oh, they killed a mighty prophet, man. Things happened, man. It got dark, man, during noon, and an earthquake, and man, just a whole lot of stuff, man. Where you been? You know, so Yahshua's trying to explain to him and said, oh, you know, earlier they said, oh, fools are slow of heart, you know. Is that what it said? Mm-hmm. Yeah, to believe what the prophets have spoken, but keep reading because we're out of time.
Mm-hmm. Keep reading. They drew nigh unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further.
Uh-huh.
But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent.
So they were walking along, and he was going to go on. They said, no, man, it's getting dark, man. Well, just hang out, man. You know, hang out with us, okay? Read.
And he went in to tarry with them.
Uh-huh.
And it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave it to them.
He took bread. Why did he take bread? Look, it's during the 40-day period, and it's in the holy place.
Yeah.
Took bread. Draw a line.
There it is.
Table of shoe bread. Mm-hmm. See that now? Mm-hmm. So now, during the 40-day period here in this holy place, we've identified the light, the bread, and the intercessor, or the spices, type being the type of that.
Yeah.
See, and that's what's happening. See, that's what you look for in the stories. Mm-hmm. You look for these principles that are in the pattern and or the migratory pattern. You look for those principles in the story.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, get Acts 1, 2.
Acts 1 and 2, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he who the Holy Spirit had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days.
Being seen of them 40 days. See, that shows, you know, how long he tarried on earth. Why 40 days? As we explained earlier, that the Israelites, they were out here 40 years.
Yeah.
In the wilderness out here. Plus also, Joshua conquered Canaan's land for 40 years. It took him 40 years to conquer Canaan's land. Mm-hmm. That also would be correlated to that as well. Mm-hmm. 40 years that Joshua took to conquer Canaan's land. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I want to keep going.
Speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
and being assembled together with them, mm-hmm. commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, you have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Rabbi, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father had put in his own power. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
Uh-huh.
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld him, he was taken up, and the cloud received him out of their sight.
Okay, now, he was taken up. In other words, he was already appearing to them in a vision. Now he appeared to them out of their sight. In other words, He went behind the veil of inscrutability. Now the world looks at that and says he is taken up on a cloud. They look at it physically because one, they believe that he resurrected physically.
Yeah.
Two, they believe he physically went up on a cloud. And three, they believe because of one and two, they believe that he will physically come back on a cloud. Okay. Now, it took me all this time to get to the central point of what I wanted to get to. But what Yahshua was doing here is a fulfillment to what the high priest did, what we explained earlier. Because
yeah.
See, when the high priest, when he came up here each time on the Day of Atonement to go up here, he had to get coals from the altar of incense and put it on the censer. So he literally came up on a cloud.
Mm-hmm.
See, he was enveloped in a cloud going up here to administer the blood up here to the altar, to the Ark of the Covenant. Okay? So, and look, and look, just draw a line. Because there were two men in apparel, you know, that were there. Mm-hmm. See, draw a line. Just like you got the cloud sitting on the mercy seat, and you got Michael and Gabriel here. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, I'll keep reading in Acts. Let me finish that up quickly.
To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days.
Where are you at?
Acts 1 and 3.
Why? Because that's not where you stopped.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry, 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Rabbi, well, I read that already, 2. 7, and he said unto them, it is not, no, 8. Okay, where was I?
Right.
8. But you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both at Jerusalem, in all Judea, in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld him, he was taken with a cloud. He was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly upward, heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up into heaven? This same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet.
That's called Olivet, okay, that's good enough. Now, this is a fulfillment of Moses' third trip into the mount, right here, mm-hmm. okay? And see, and it also shows forth the high priest on the Day of Atonement, the garments that he wore. Here's what I say. The first time he went up, he wore linen garments. The second time he went up, he wore linen garments. Mm-hmm. But the third time he went up, he wore garments of beauty and glory. Mm-hmm. All right? Here's how to prove that. When Yahshua went up this mountain the first time, in fulfillment of Moses' first trip, the Sermon on the Mount, he was in a physical body. Mm-hmm. He was in the flesh. Mm-hmm. Second time Yahshua went up in the mount to fulfill Moses, he was in the flesh, even though he transfigured, but he was still, he transfigured, then he transfigured back into a physical body. Mm-hmm. He was still a physical body. Mm-hmm. Third trip he went up, see, here he is here, he's a physical body, and his death, and his burial, and now here's his resurrection. He resurrects a quickening spirit. That would be like the garments of beauty and glory. Mm-hmm. And see, because he goes up here and he ascends on a cloud. See, so now he's here. Now he's on the mount here, but he's not in the flesh. He's a quickening spirit, which is likened to the garments of beauty and glory. So that's why I say the high priest went up. In other words, the high priest went up first time with white linen, second time with white linen, third time the garments of beauty and glory. Yes.
He was a quickening spirit, but then he told Thomas to touch him, and then did he eat with them?
Yeah, he sure did.
How can he eat as a spirit?
Because the spirit has the power to transmute.
Uh-huh.
See, into matter is spirit materialized. See, he can take on a body off and on whenever he wants.
Mm-hmm. I see.
It's not like, well, okay, well, I gotta wait till a certain time and then I can become flesh. No, he could do this instantaneously.
Mm-hmm.
That's how Joshua appeared down here in Egypt. He appeared down here 50 years after Moses left Egypt. He just, bam, he just came into a body. It didn't take, you know, a whole long time to, you know, to get a clone and grow into it. You know, mm-hmm. Bam, he's just right there. Now, first you blink and then all of a sudden he's like, oh, hi, where'd you come from?
Yeah.
You know? And see, and they didn't know who he was down here. They just said, oh, who's that guy? Oh, you know him, man. That's Hoshea, yeah? Hoshea who? Oh, you know, what's that? Old Man Nun's son. Oh, him. Oh, what tribe is he from? Ephraim, I think?
40 years old.
Hour 59.
Okay, so I'll pretty much, yeah. Does anybody have any other questions? But yeah, see, all of these things, the vision, I'll put it like this, the vision hinges off these two plates. If you know the correlation between the tabernacle pattern and the migratory pattern, you can understand every chart in this room. Barnum, because it all stems from that, from the correlation between the two. Mm-hmm. And just knowing, see, just knowing the bloodline, water line, spirit line, knowing that there's a 40 here, there's a light, there's a bread, there's an intercessor, there's a principle of a veil, this is a principle of heaven. That's half the battle to me. I mean, that's really it. Mm-hmm. And all you're doing, and see, Yahweh is just going to, all you're doing is reviewing the record. And in doing so, Yahweh will show you how all these things will come together. Yes, sir, Dr. Samuel.
Okay, yeah.
Where's the microphone?
It's a little tiny. When Moses left Egypt, 10 years after Yahshua appeared,
mm-hmm.
appeared as a grown man or as a...
Grown man. There was no birth with Joshua.
Okay, so he was a grown man for 30 years.
For 30
was,
years.
When Moses came back, he was 30 years.
That's exactly right. That's right. That's where I understood. He was 30 years old for 30 years.
That's right.
He looked like he was 30 years old for 30 years.
Yes.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Because remember, there was a death decree that had to kill all the boy babies.
Mm.
Well, Yahweh just threw a curve. Instead of coming in through a woman, he just appeared down there.
Yeah. Mm.
And just started walking around. And they didn't know any difference.
Yeah.
They didn't know any better. They didn't. This is Yahweh. Is anything too hard for Yahweh?
Mm.
That he can't walk down into his creation and then, you know, he can let them recognize him or not. Just like the story we read. Mm. About Balaam and his ass. Balaam couldn't see Yahweh, but his ass could.
Mm.
His ass saved his ass, if you really stop and think about it.
Very funny.
I don't know. Terrible joke. We're out of time. Any other questions anybody have, anything? Look, all I say is take the time and review the record. Our founder, he laid it out. And play with these charts. Go home, don't just wait to come here and start. Go home and look at these charts. Look at the principles in it, and just compare. Mm-hmm. And you'll see. You'll see that it's all the same
mm-hmm.
in principle. Manifestation will change, but the principle will always remain the same. With those few words.
Hallelujah.
I'll be gone for the next 6 weeks. Yeah, I start summer school next week, so it's on a Tuesday, so, and it's one of these classes I need. So I'll be gone for 6 weeks, and you folks can do what you like. You can keep going with workshop, or have lectures, or testimony night, or whatever. But all I just simply say is delve into this vision. You know, that's my exhortation.
Well, I'll be gone from this Sunday till I'll be back for July 1st for our business meeting.
Okay.
So if someone will take the roll.
Okay. We want to thank you for another lecture sponsored by the Institute of Divine Benefits and Research. We hold classes on Tuesdays and Fridays from 7:30 to 9:30. And we hold classes on Sundays from 11 to 1. And on the fourth Sunday of the month, we have Spanish class from 9:30 to 10:45. All donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lloyd Lawless. Let's all stand and be dismissed for the doxology.
I can hardly hear you.
I'm not sure what it is.
I think you might be speaking on the wrong side. Yeah.
Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, present you falling for the presence of his Lord with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua Messiah, sovereign, belong to the Lord, imagining dominion and power, both for all times now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I don't want to send a check in and I will separate
it from my own. You have to keep this straight again, so have, you know, get it up, keep it up here so that when you move, it'll stay there.
And you said maybe when you probably get some take and put it on.
No, this is probably because, well.
Just be aware.
Yeah, that's the thing. Just be aware. Just be aware.
They are. No, but my nephew's a little more right now, so. until his wife comes back.
Yeah, just be aware.
It works.
You could just turn this off right
now.
Where's he at?